Monday, March 2nd, 11:38 p.m. If you can see that, there you go. 2020. Do this. Watch it a lot on TV. a person right now. I feel like I'm just, like, talking to my computer, which feels weird. But, like, I also watch a lot of YouTube, so, like, story times are not non-existent to me. I don't know if that's what this is. It just feels like I need to turn on the camera. I don't know why. And it's like an urge. I've had it for like days. I've had thoughts about it before. Just like opening the laptop, pressing record, and just like talking about it. So I don't have to like keep repeating it to people. You know? All I know is that it gets easier when I tell the stories, but I can't keep telling the stories. Because that's getting hard. And at first it was liberating, and I felt heard. You know. I don't even want to remember. That's normal, you know? And, like, to cope with that, like, you go see a doctor, right? And, like, I did. And I do. I see a lot of them. Lot of their time spent on me trying to figure out what's going on. And like, sometimes I feel like I'm not even helping them because, like, I don't even know what's going on. So, like, how am I supposed to tell them? And, like, it's so fixated. Like, the fact that, like, the brain is, like, the only organ a doctor doesn't physically examine. They just talk to you about your brain. And, like, I can't do it anymore. Like, I can't keep talking about it. I feel like it needs to be more than that. Like, it hurts me to talk about it all the time, every day, until it's, like, desensitized to myself, and it shouldn't be desensitized. Like, I should be able to feel my feelings, and that's okay, and, like, I'm allowed to be traumatized, and I'm allowed to be depressed, and angry, and I'm allowed to, like, want my life back and not have to prove that to anyone. My best friend died. That's traumatic. Yesterday, I woke up in my home, in my bed, by myself, and he was on the floor. And he was really sick, and he was in a lot of pain, he was old, and we woke up, I scooped him up. And my first thought was, because of my medication, I was so asleep that I didn't hear you or feel you jump off the bed or fall off the bed. And I don't know if you hurt your head or your body. And I'm wondering all the time if you were getting better and that fall made it happen to you. And there's no way to know, you know, like, of course you could do like a post and everything and like, you can afford that. We at least got to put him to sleep and be with him, and that was wow. It was so hard to hold him in that moment, in that morning, yesterday. I'm so dissociated from it. Like, it was fucking yesterday, and I keep saying it like it was historical, you know? I don't know how to cope with it. Growing up, our pets were always, like, you know, taken care of. Like, we didn't see the end of life. It was always like, oh, they ran away, you know? Like, you know, it's crazy. It happened. Under the deck and gone, whoosh. I'm so sorry. Or forget to feed a hamster when you're six and it dies, you know, and like it just disappears. And when your dogs get sick as a kid and your parents just take care of it for you, and they say that they went somewhere nice, like a farm. But that doesn't make a lot of sense when you live on a farm, you know? When you grow up on a farm. When you treat dogs like they can't come in homes. Like they're less than lovable. They're incredible. All animals are so incredible. We're so blessed to have them. And to have them so domesticated that they would love us unconditionally enough to be a therapy dog. You know? Like, that's amazing. And so selfless. Hard to imagine life without your best friend. And I tried. We got him when he was 9. He had a backstory. He had a whole life. You know? He was a 9-year-old mini schnauzer. His name's Buddy. His name was Buddy. When I first saw him in person, I was scared of him. I never met a dog like him before. I assumed that dogs that looked like him were aggressive. And I was really scared that he would be rough with me, or like he wouldn't want to, you know, let me near him. Because that's how I was at the time. Like he'd bite me, you know. Like that's just how I was. I was aggressive, and like I didn't want him to feel that, you know. And like that brought me out of that anger. And he wasn't supposed to be a therapy dog. He was our family dog, you know. Like he wasn't a trained therapy dog. He wasn't something we planned. He was someone's family pet, and they died, and he was there when they died, and it was so traumatic for him to be there with his person and watch that, and we were told that he wasn't found for like a couple of days maybe, so Buddy was just there with his person. And that's just so sad. Like, we don't know anything, you know? Like, they didn't tell us what happened to the dog while this is happening. We didn't know, like, any of those details. Like, we just tried to assume the best. Like, and we coped with his anxieties from that. And he had a lot, you know? Like, dogs go through trauma too, and being alone with a dead person for a dog is intense, and it's life-threatening, and so many possibilities go through your head when you hear that story. So I was scared. I was scared of, like, is he gonna eat me? I don't fucking know. Like, am I asleep and, like, he thinks I'm dead? Is he used to that? I don't know. Like, that's ridiculous. But, like, it was a thought and, like, a fear. And, like, it wasn't a case, you know? And, like, all my fears were proven wrong through this also terribly traumatized little dude. And, like, he just needed love. And I just need love. So it was, like, serendipity that my mom just happened to work with his neighbor, and he couldn't go to his family, so he needed a place to go. And, like, my mom just happened to be the first one to say, we'll take him. You know, like, a lot of people wanted that dog. He was a great dog. Beautiful. Incredibly well trained. I don't understand how he was trained, and I kind of don't want to. But he was so smart and loyal. He chose me, you know. We worked together for months. He didn't want to be touched. He growled every time you would try to hold him and put him in a car because he was smaller. Anytime anyone came to the door, he would go crazy. He would just, like, bark his head off, you know. Loud people in the home. or like people that were like trying to get him going, he would get really defensive and like protective, you know, and like growl at them and like get really upset. And like, he also had this incredible, like, way of just, like, being. Like, he was an incredibly independent yet codependent dog. He only wanted to be so close to you at all times. And I loved that about him. Especially other beings. So getting a dog was nerve-wracking because you assume like cuddling and all of that is just not something for me that's ideal right now, or like maybe ever. I don't know. I'm working on it. But with him, like, it was something we worked on together. He would only give me his paw. That was it. Just one. And then eventually it was two paws. And that was really exciting. Because then eventually we could kind of like push him and he would do like a stretch and like stretch all the way forward up and like press up against your hands, you know, and like that felt good. That trust that he built with us felt so good. It gave me like I was proud of myself, you know, for helping him do that and like trusting me, like we became like the best buddies, you know. He's my best buddy, my little shadow, my gray shadow. He always knew when I wasn't good, you know, like even when I was like full on faking it, and like he knew. He'd come over and put a paw on me, and it would just like take me out of my head. He wasn't trained to do that, you know? I miss him so much right now. He was wonderful, and every person that met that tiny little fucking dog smiled. It was in his walk. On Monday we went to the park and pranced, you know, for a long walk. I took him on a long walk. Kind of had like this gut feeling, like I knew this was going to be the last long walk. And like, I'm not physically able right now to go on a long walk. So I did it. And I mean, I put myself at risk. And I know that. But it felt like it was something I had to do. And we took our time, you know. He's old. He was 15. So we were both pretty slow. Probably looked funny, but like, I don't know. I just took my time. And like, every time he wanted to stop, we stopped. You know, it wasn't just like, oh, come on, get your peas out. Like, it was real. And I was embracing all of it, and it was beautiful. He got to smell other dogs that day. He met strangers who asked about him and told me how beautiful he was and how they loved how he pranced. And, like, those are things I've always heard about him, you know? Like, he's one of a kind. People always said that I've never seen a schnauzer like that. Are you sure he's a mini? Like, I'm just like, why get? Like, that's what they told me. That's paperwork says so. I don't know. Like, but yeah. Like, his color is so unique. Like, wow, he's silver. Like, that's crazy. And I'm just like, yeah, he's beautiful. And, like, he was the dog I used to draw when I was a kid. Like, one ear up, one ear down, and a beard. It was fucking weird, like, that he happened to be the one. And, like, today is, like, the first day I have ever been without my dog. And awake. Terrifying. Liberating. It's exhausting. And it's hard. But it's good. And it's harder because I just didn't get that kind of education about this stuff. And I didn't know, you know, like that. Well, of course life ends, right? For a dog. But I never saw it until today or yesterday. It was the end of the cycle that I needed with my best friend, because he was there for his best friend, you know? And, like, for me to hold my best friend while he stopped being in pain, that was good enough. And I felt his heart stop, you know? And I pet his fur a little bit longer. And I smelt his fur one last time. And the vet took him with the blanket. Because I didn't want to see it again, you know? And before he left, I gave him a kiss on the head. And I told him that I'd see him again. And we would play together one day. Tip of the iceberg, you know. Losing your best friend, your dog, the thing you're responsible for. It made me question if I had done anything wrong, which made me question what else I was doing wrong. And to be honest, there's a lot. mostly, like, personal stuff, like, obviously my body is not what it should look like for my height and age. It's not healthy. My vitals are apparently fine. My blood work was fine. But, like, I don't feel good. And I take this many things a day. And I can't work. So, I mean, between morning, no food to make me hungry, to antibiotics with food 3 times a day to help with infection, and some anti-anxieties whenever I have anxieties, mixed with antidepressants that I take at night with my sleeping pills so that I can sleep. 28-year-old lady. Fucking dope, yo. Bullshit. What happened to me was preventable. And I reported it. Because it nearly killed me. And if I didn't report it, I probably would have killed myself. And that's the hard truth. Because I'm pretty close right now to fading away. And all these meds are to get me back up, you know? They're not stuff I've been taking. They're new. Mental health is fucking insane, you know? I don't know for sure what my diagnoses are. I have inklings and clues, but there's no way to navigate this. Not really. Not like when you yourself are mentally ill and you're being asked to try and figure out what your symptoms are. I don't even know what feelings I'm feeling sometimes, or like what I did 3 minutes ago, because I have spots and I don't know why, and like I don't remember that I have spots, and like it's not that I don't want to be healthy, it's that I don't know that I'm not healthy, and like all of these disorders pile on, and then there's stress, and then there's adversity, and then there's trauma, and then there's therapy, and then there's hard conversations with people who love you, explaining what happened to you, because they don't understand why you are the way you are, or why you crashed and burned so fucking bad that they don't understand, and you have to explain it to them so that they could possibly understand it. That's not my job. I'm not sorry. I Like, it shouldn't have happened to me. And I really want to make sure it never happens to anyone else. That's all. I don't know if I'll ever be able to work again. I knew what I wanted to do when I was 14. And I did it. I made it. I made it out. I proved everyone wrong. Every person said I wasn't going to do it. I did it. And not only did I do it, I got promoted. And I don't know if I got that promotion because I was good or because of what they did to me. Because I was quiet, you know? Like, I don't think I'll ever really know that. And I don't know if it matters, really. But it sucks. Because, like, it's like a looming thing, you know? Like, I was just that malleable junior who didn't say no and then kept quiet and laughed at the uncomfortable jokes. They didn't know I was the breadwinner of my family. 21, you know? I didn't know my mom was going through the most traumatic divorce since my father. And that I was sending half of my paychecks back to my mom and my sister while my sister was going through her first year of college. Like, I had to stay. That's what you do. When you grow up and you make it out, you fight for your family. So I did. And that's how I got through it. I go home a lot. And I tried to forget. And then it got harder. To lie to everyone about how great it was, how much amazing work I was doing, and how much I was learning. It was like one white lie led to another. Led to another, led to another, led to a facade that I was this badass graphic designer that worked her ass off to be an art director and was killing it, left at the top of her career to freelance, kept moving it up, and then just decided to go home. It doesn't make any sense. And nobody ever asked, you know? I've worked with hundreds of people. And, like, it's not an unknown fact that that place is dangerous. But it was to me. My first job. 1 year out of college. Felt like professional met college, you know, and I was an anomaly. I really good at beer pong. Thought that was cool, I guess. Especially when you have a beer client. You have a bar in your office. You have parties all the time. And it's all free. Stories that I've been told since I've told mine are fucked up. And I'm okay with hearing them. I'm a safe person, you can tell. I'm not gonna do this with your story. Ever. Yours. But I want you to know it gives me strength. It makes me very mad. It makes me really motivated. But most of all, it makes me really, really empowered. Want to do something. I'm still paying back student debt for something I don't even do anymore, and I probably won't ever do again. And I've tried. Trust me. It's traumatic to open my fucking laptop programs, you know? That's something I've been working on for like 5.5 years. That's crazy. Like, I don't know how you explain to your siblings why you can't design them a new resume, but I don't either. I've come up with every excuse I possibly could. And in the end, I end up doing it because it was easier than the truth. Excuse me. I started remembering everything last year. My doctor said that it's normal. I've been through a lot of therapy and getting back into the workforce possibly triggered a lot of flashbacks and memories from what happened to me at work type of stuff. It just feels surreal. And it's like the only thing I can compare it to is when I've seen a movie where they have like amnesia and they wake up and they're like, I don't remember what happened. I'm like, oh, it's okay, you'll be fine. We'll get you better. And then one day they just like remember. And it's like not all at once, it's like slow. And it's not like stop you in your tracks moments. It's like you're watching a TV show and somebody says something that somebody else said to you, you know, and you remember. And you look around at your family and you're like, should I tell them that? I just remembered that and ruined this fucking movie? Or should I just like try and forget? Because, like, no one will ever really know, you know? It's true. recently, like, the most recent ones were, like, the most vivid. And they were, like, happening because I was going to my manager at work and telling her, like, I didn't want. Like, I was, like, complaining about how somebody had physically, like, grabbed my arms, like this. And was like, rah! And, like, said something. I barely remember what they said because I, like, blacked out because they were touching me. So, I told her, I was like, I was assaulted. Like, I was. Like, at work. I was working. She came up to me. She was working. It was on the floor in front of customers. And she just took both my arms and shook me and, like, kept saying something like, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, please don't touch me. I don't like to be touched. And she was just like, okay. And I was like, I'm sorry, I just don't like being touched physically. And she's like walked away and like kind of laughed about it. And I was like, what the fuck just happened? Like, I kind of like looked around and it was like customers kind of looking at me. And I was like, okay, well, I'm just going to pretend I'm going to go back to my job and try and figure out what just happened. While I look like I'm working. And I did. But I didn't do it very well. So I kind of cracked. And I ran to the manager on duty and was like, I need to go home. I need to take my medication. And have a panic attack. She was like, oh my god, what can I do? And I was like, don't touch me. It's funny now because, like, I'm dissociated from it. Like, it's the only way I can really cope with that kind of shit. There's so much shit. But that, like, going to her, like, her letting me go home was, like, wicked. Like, she was top notch. I would have, like, that woman was treated like, balls, like bullshit, like, you know, like, not that balls are bullshit, just like, she deserved way better, but, like, she cared about me, you know, and so I went home, and I told, the manager about it. And she was like, oh my god, like, I'm so sorry, like, do you need anything, are you okay, and, like, blah, blah, blah. And, I was just like, I don't know what I fucking need, you know, like, this just happened to me, like, don't you, like, in my head, I was like, I just need to be at home, and so that's what I said to her, and, like, a couple days later, we worked together again, and it was like, flood of flashbacks as soon as I walked in the door or, like, saw her. Like, hairs raised on the back of your neck. Like all the way down your spine. Terror. I would refer to it. Just, like, pure frozen in the moment, trying to collect your face so that you don't show that you're vulnerable. Terror. Just to be seeing her. And, like, let alone working the same shift. And I did. I got it together. Fuck, I did that. I think I had a cigarette, honestly. I just, like, went outside. I was like, oh my god. And I came back inside. I was like, you know what? Like, she touches you again, react, because, like, you told her not to, so there's cameras, and, like, you gotta work. Didn't really think to question the manager on why she was still there, I guess. I do now, but hindsight is the year 2020, so there's that. So yeah, I just kind of like kept getting them. And I remember I had like a pretty good rapport with the owner because I was doing graphic design for him. He was really nice. He was good. You know, I was going through like some shit with my mental health and threw me a couple jobs and stuff. And like, I asked for like more work. So they put me in the actual business to do part time, which was like really nice. And it just really fucked me up. Like, it wasn't like a good idea, you know? So, I remember asking him, like, would you be upset if, like, I pursue charges? Like, she is, like, obviously unabashed by this and doesn't care, and there's no discipline, and I've already reported it, and, like, nothing's been done. And he just kind of, like, looked at me, like, as, like, a business associate, not as, like, his employee, and was like, well, I would assume that out of respect for our business relationship, you would not ever press charges against one of my employees. I was like, okay. Like, yeah, no, totally. Whatever. Yeah, same. Yeah, I totally understand that. Okay. Got it. Exit strategy. You know? Like, red flag one. And, like, that conversation alone of him just saying, like, he would be upset if I got somebody else involved, even though I asked him to take care of it, triggered even more flashbacks. And it was, like, rough. And, like, I was going home, and I was just getting super high off weed, like the highest THC content possible, just numb, with batch, like, with tobacco in the bottom, like, full, like, just didn't give a fuck. Like, I was no self-care at all. I was, like, disheveled puddle on the floor, ripping tokes until I got sick to feel something other than like fear or like flashbacks, you know, like I was not coping well at all. I was very unhealthy. Yeah. And I was bad. And my partner at the time was just watching it, you know, like he was there rubbing my back. He was there like, you know, he made me some food and like told me it would be okay, but he never really listened to me, you know? And like when it came down to it, like I should have been in a hospital essentially. Like I should have been rushed to a hospital. I should have been encouraged to be seeing counselors, and I shouldn't have been encouraged to smoke so much weed with him all the time. You know, like I should have had a partner and not like a drug buddy to cope with our sadness. Like it was really sick. And like the whole time we were together, it was like I was just getting sicker and sicker. And like I knew it, you know. Like, I knew deep down that, like, my eating disorder was thriving. And, like, somehow that outweighed my family, my sister especially, my job, my self-worth, my friends, and, like, essentially my dog. And, like, what a fucking wake-up call. I know he was older. He was 15. And, like, he had previous conditions. But I'll never not, you know. Yeah. I'll never not blame me for that deep down. Deep down. I might be able to eventually get over it. But, like, I will always remember that, and like, I think that's a good thing. I think that is a very awakening thing for me. I've never considered myself a drug addict, but I do believe that I have the worst coping mechanisms, and I'm trying my best, but I think it's important that, like, an animal wasn't involved, you know? Like, I really wish that it was never, like, my dog was never involved at all in my life. Like, it should have never been the situation. It should have never, I love him, and I cherish him, and I know he had a good life with us. However, he would have had a much better life and end of life with another family. And I do truly believe that in my heart. And that makes me really sad. Like, I was just neglectful because I was neglecting myself. And, I don't want to say that you shouldn't give a sick person an animal, because I don't believe that at all. I believe that I needed my family more than they thought I needed them. And getting me the dog was a really uneducated decision on behalf of, like, my family. He was meant to be the family dog, but he turned into my dog and my responsibility. And my responsibility should have been myself. So there's no one to blame, really. We all had good intentions. It's just, like, a learning experience. And, like, radically accepting that, like, I will never do that to any animal or myself ever again. Or my family. Like, just those lessons. Like, that's what yesterday was, and today is for me. Like, today is the first time I've ever felt alone. And there's cats here, but they're not my dog. And, like, I'm okay with that now. I think. I mean, I don't know. We'll see. There's a lot going on. I don't want people to worry about me. I have a good support system here. And it took a lot of work to get that, but I have it now. And I'm not going anywhere. And I'm not physically able to do a lot of things. But I'm mentally fine. Like, kind of what happens when you go through, like, years of therapy and then just, you know, grow, evolve, I don't know, learn. I'm 28, I guess, like, I've matured. I don't know. There's a lot of growth to be had. Obviously. But we'll get there. And I just have to remember to not isolate myself and talk to people. My people. People that I know want the best for me and don't just want me for something. Learning to love me. One day at a time. Thank you.